Well, good morning. What a great morning. We couldn't have picked a better day for the symposium. If you have been attending our symposium over the past 7 years, you probably know what I mean. Invariably, our symposium has brought in bad weather. We have had record cold temperature, record snow, and everything bad that you can expect on the day of the symposium in the past. I don't want to jinx it, but enjoy the nice weather while it lasts. My name is Shibu Jos. I'm the director of the Center for Agroforestry at the University of Missouri. So on behalf of the center, it's my pleasure to present to you the 7th annual Agroforestry Symposium, The Future of Pollinators, Why Agroforestry Matters. My role is to introduce Dr. Tom Payne, but let me say a few words before I do so. Well, why did we choose this theme for this year's symposium? I'm sure you will all agree with me that it is a timely topic. Everyone is talking about pollinators, but why? Pollinators, such as most bees and some birds and bats and other insects, play a crucial role in flowering plant reproduction and in the production of most fruits, nuts, and vegetables that we eat. A 2012 study showed that crops pollinated by honeybees and other insects contributed $29 billion to farm income in the US. But recent trends of declining wild pollinators, as well as managed bees, have caused concerns, not only in the US, but also in Europe, Asia, and also in other parts of the world. Agroforestry, by way of including a diverse mix of woody as well as non-woody plants on the farms and over the landscape, has been suggested by many folks as one of the solutions to the issue here. There are projects related to this topic happening at the University of Missouri and elsewhere in the US. So we wanted to invite a cross-section of those researchers and professionals to come and share their latest findings and stories with us today. So throughout the day, an excellent slate of speakers and panelists will explore the theme of pollinators in detail. These speakers are some of the best in their field, and we are fortunate to bring them to you today. We are also fortunate to open the symposium to the public free of charge and broadcast it live globally. So keep in mind, we have audience joining us over online. And last year we had nearly 400 people attending the symposium using live streaming. We have our graduate students and postdocs presenting their research as posters, and they will be displayed throughout the day. We also have several exhibitors displaying their programs, so I encourage you to visit the posters and exhibitors during the breaks and the poster session this afternoon. I would be remiss if I did not mention the generous support that we received from our sponsors. Thank you. Your contributions made a big difference in organizing this event. So without further ado, I would like to introduce Dr. Tom Payne, Vice Chancellor and Dean of the College of Agriculture, Food and Natural Resources, and Director of the Missouri Agricultural Experiment Station at the University of Missouri, to welcome you to the symposium and introduce the keynote speaker, Dr. Payne.
Man, you got a whole bunch of notes here. Those are the same ones you gave me as my introductory remarks. Welcome. Welcome to the 7th annual agroforestry workshop that's been going on for 7 years, right? So agroforestry got started here in 1999 by Gene Garrett. He's really old and may not have gotten here. Is he in the audience? Welcome. And Shabu is the Garrett Endowed Professorship, a position that was created to honor Gene Garrett, and we're very fortunate that Shabu's here in that role, the first and hopefully the long-lasting one, and you stay for a long time. This is a very important program, as you well know, with the goal of trying to preserve economically, socially, and environmentally forestry, agroforestry interactions in the urban and rural areas. Most all of you here in the audience are part of the choir. You know all about this, far more than I do. The topic of pollinators is very important. I'm an entomologist by training, a long time ago. I still can tell that insects have six legs. Spiders are not insects, nor are ticks and mites that we get sent a lot. I just never understood why people couldn't count six versus eight. But when I started out in entomology back in the 60s, we knew a lot of things, and I left my introductory classes thinking that everything that we ate and everything that we enjoyed from a fauna standpoint was the result of an insect. And of course, we know that pollinators account for about a third, or maybe really more than a third, of the food that we have globally through pollination. Well, let's go back to what I said about invertebrates in general having a responsibility. That's anthropomorphic, and I would be dunned for having said that. A function of helping provide all of the food we consume. Because whether they pollinate or not, they help fertilize. Think of where we would be if we didn't have domestic beetles and blowflies and stuff like that that take care of all the road kills. I mean, you'd be dodging down the highway, not just armadillos, but you'd be dodging everything else. So insects play a major role. But as pollinators, it's extremely important. And our speaker today, Scott Hoffman Black, they put that in there. And are you related to Abby Hoffman?
I am not.
I'm just checking to see how the general age group of the audience. And just as an aside, we were talking about mushrooms a moment ago. Those of you that know the word psilocybin, raise your hands. This is pretty cool. Some of you look like you've been using it this morning. But Scott, as you know, is director of the Xerces Institute. Did I pronounce that correctly?
Xerces Society.
Oh, it's a society. That's even better. The Xerces Society, which is dedicated to, I guess I would say you're dedicated to life on the planet. Wouldn't you say that?
Exactly.
And attaching that to the importance of pollinators is very easy. In the last several years, we've been very concerned about pollinators, primarily because of bees. You all know about colony collapse, which has been attributed to a variety of things, everything from cell phones. How many of you are texting right now? Those of you that take psilocybin probably don't even have a cell phone, the rest of the people that do. But we're very concerned about that. And as we know now and have done a lot of research, and Scott's very familiar with that, the collapse can be attributed to a whole variety of things. And it's the culmination of all those things together. The nicotinamides that are, you know, botanical-based pesticide synthetics to not re-upping your colony to mites and all sorts of things causing these things to happen. Bottom line is it's increased the sensitivity of people to the word pollinator or pollination. What in the world is it? And that it's not just bees. It's all kinds of things. Bats. Even us. I mean, we're here because some of us pollinated. You know, the roundabout. Scott comes to us with a lot of experience. I have a whole list of things, which they're probably on. You took the notes. My God, that's just. No, I'm kidding you. I'm just jiving you. He's so organized and uptight. And he's from India. I'm from California. That I give you a difference. I come from the land of fruits and nuts and flakes. And you can go any place you want with that. I do have some notes, and I want to mention it because I don't want to goof up on introducing Scott. And I think it's very important. He is here with the Xerces Society, and it was on the notes. It was formed in 1971 with that focus. And there's a great deal of attention from that society on invertebrates. And it's for the reasons that I've just mentioned to you. And that organization is responsible for a lot of education that's gone around the country. And in Scott's career thus far, he spent a lot of time doing research and working with people and putting on gatherings and coming to events like this to help spread the word, which is important. I noted here, I thought this was, to me as an entomologist, chair of the International Union of Conservation of Nature Butterfly Specialist Group. You all know about butterflies, right? What's the most famous butterfly you know? Haven't you ever heard of the carnate blue? Yeah, well, anyway. Held up some progress on the part of some people. Butterflies, moths. Did you know moths are pollinators? Yeah, that's really interesting. But the other thing I noted here, which I found very interesting and I was happy to see, is chair of the Migratory Dragonfly Partnership. That's pretty good. Do you know the difference between a dragonfly and a damselfly? What? What is it? I never got that right on my tests. Scott's responsible for publishing research and popular articles, a couple of hundred of those, has been recognized for the work he's done by our own Entomological Society of America. He was recognized at the Premier Presentation Award in 2015, which is a big deal. So ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, I guess you're ready to speak. I'd like to introduce, let's give this pollinator and speaker of pollination a great round of applause.
Thanks for that great introduction. That's awesome. And it's great to have somebody with the depth of knowledge that you have to talk about the importance of these animals. Because I think when you think of invertebrates, you know, 98% of animals on the planet are invertebrates. 93% are insects. And without these animals, again, as was said, life on the planet would not be possible. So I take it the mic is working. Can you hear me all right up there? Great. So I'm going to lay the context today. We're talking about agroforestry, but I'm going to give some context on pollinators and then just start to discuss how agroforestry can be part of this solution. The first part of my talk is really depressing, and it will make us all just want to go, I don't know about psilocybin, because I haven't done that, but tequila, you know, I can go for the tequila when I get depressed. So, but we're not going to go there. We're going to have some depressing statistics, and then we're going to talk about solutions. Because to me, I really want to always talk about the solutions, not just the problems. But to get to the solutions, we have to understand those problems. Before I give any talk, I always want to do my thank yous first, because there are so many people that are responsible for me being able to go across North America, across Europe, and even beyond that, to really spread a message of conservation. And first of all, thank you so much for the organizers of this symposium. Thanks to Gregory for reaching out to me, and thanks to all of you for coming to listen about agroforestry and how you can make a difference. And I think that's really important. I also want to thank my family. I do this because of my kids. I want a place that they should have in the future. I want a world that they want to live in. And I've got a beautiful wife and wonderful kids. I travel a little too much, but they get it. They get that I do this for an important reason. And I'm indoctrinating them to understand that these insects and other invertebrates are really the basis of life. When I came onto the Xerces Society in 2000, we had about 5 funders. And now I can barely fit them on this page. We've got over 8,000 members, many foundations, government agencies, and corporations that support us, because it's an important issue that we need to address. And I come from Nebraska. If somebody gives me money, I'm always startled that people want to give me money to do my work. And so I want to do a good job with that funding. So that's what we try to do, but we have a lot of wonderful, wonderful funders. As a scientific society, as a society that uses science as the basis for our work, we work with a tremendous number of scientists across the country. We translate research into practice. And to do that, we have scientific advisors actually all over the world. And this is just a few of the folks that we work with in that realm. And then last but not least, we have now over 40 committed staff that really do the hard work of the Xerces Society. I get to get up and rally people, get to get people excited about this, and they're really out there doing the work. I just get to go and have the fun. And it's incredible to see the brain trust that Xerces has been able to build over the last few years. For those of you who don't know the Xerces Society, I just quickly want to tell you who we are. We are the Xerces Society. I'm glad you got Xerces right, because I've been in farmer meetings where somebody will come up and say, "So are you the Xerces Society? What exactly is that?" We are the Xerces Society. We're named after the first butterfly to go extinct due to humans in North America. As San Francisco expanded during World War II, they built on the last habitat of the Xerces blue butterfly. Robert Michael Pyle founded this organization in 1971 because he wanted an organization that looked out for something. Tigers and bears and all these charismatic megafauna are really important, but he wanted an organization that looked out for the base of the food chain. So how do we do our work? We do science. We cannot conserve animals unless we understand them and what their needs are. So we work with agencies and private landowners to basically understand the habitat and management needs for invertebrates. We harness citizens. We have tens of thousands of citizens who are helping us to get the data that we need through things like Bumblebee Watch and our Migratory Dragonfly Partnership and studying overwintering monarchs, because it's great to have university scientists working with us, but if we can harness a broader cross-section, we can do more. We do education and outreach, as was said. In the last 6 years, we've reached over 45,000 professionals and others through workshops, farm tours, and talks like this one, and trainings in all 50 states, Canada, Mexico, Europe, and Asia. And then the underpinning of it all is really our restoration ecology. We work with restoration practitioners to put pollinators and other invertebrates into the mix. And we've been able, fortunate enough to work with NRCS and FSA to implement over 200,000 acres of habitat projects across the United States in the last since 2008. And we work with a number of clients, everything from Federal Highway Administration to airports to General Mills and others. But today I'm going to talk about pollinators, and I'm going to talk about their importance, and I'm going to delve into, are they in decline, and if they are, what are the problems that they face, and then I'm going to spend the last part talking about solutions, which I think most of the other speakers are going to then talk about as well. So you heard a little bit about this, and I know this is probably Pollinator 101 for many of you, but I like to make sure that we're all on the same page. 85% of flowering plants require an animal to pollinate. Of course, we've got wind-pollinated plants as well, but 85% of flowering plants require an animal to pollinate. This means this is the only, I go to DC a lot, I speak to Congress. I was at the White House in December. This is usually the only slide I show, because they like the dollars and cents. And pollinators are responsible for about a third of our food production. When people say 1 in 3 mouthfuls of food and drink, that's actually correct. Up to $27 billion worth of crops in the United States. And it's really our most vitamin and mineral-rich food. We would have corn, we would have rice, we would have wheat, but we wouldn't have melons, we wouldn't have fruits, and we wouldn't have many of the vegetables without insect pollinators. But beyond us, because I like to think beyond just humans, these animals are really a keystone group that keeps the fabric of life on the planet intact. Whether you're a grizzly bear, whether you're a songbird, you are benefiting from the pollination of these animals. So who are the pollinators? Well, we heard a little bit about butterflies and moths. They do pollinate. I always like to think from the general public point of view, I'm going off this psilocybin thing got me thinking that pollinators are really the gateway drug, or that butterflies are really the gateway drug to real pollination. They do move pollen, but they're not likely the most important pollinators out there. Flies are pollinators. Flies are really important pollinators as you get up to tundra areas or high elevation areas. Beetles are very important, especially as you get to equatorial areas. Wasps will do some pollination, but it's that guy over there in the right-hand corner bottom that is really the key pollinator if you're talking about temperate areas of North America, Europe, as well as South America. It's the bee. Why is the bee so important for pollination? Well, unlike other animals, they actually collect and transport pollen. Most animals just either eat pollen or sip nectar, and they're moving pollen accidentally. These animals are actually collecting it, so they move much more of it. They forage in and around a nest. They're going back and forth and back and forth and back and forth, so they hit the flowers a lot, and they have flower constancy, which is important because once they find a good resource, they stick with it. I do want to mention, because I'm today talking about insects and bees mostly and butterflies, but there are other pollinators, as was mentioned earlier. Bats pollinate. Our largest pollinator, actually, that I know of is a primate that has been found to pollinate, and actually there's a slug pollinator. So although I don't think very important from an economic point of view there. So when it gets to bees, most people think of honeybees when they think of bees. But actually there are over 4,000 species of bees in North America. that are native to North America. I'll talk about honeybees in a little bit, and they come in all shapes and sizes, from over an inch long to barely able to fit on the carpenter bee's antenna. And they're beautiful, magical animals that just come in all shapes, colors, and sizes. So what I want people to do first is a different thought. When you think about a bee, think about how different they can be, the various shapes and the colors of these animals. So they're important. I think that the data suggests that pollinators are really important. Without them, we'd be in big trouble. But are pollinators in decline? Well, I'm going to make the case that we have, I think, pretty substantial evidence that they are. And first, the case of the European honeybee. The honeybee is from Europe. It's been in North America, though, since the early 1600s. Jamestown was the first documented case of honeybees being brought to the United States, and they were spread across the United States as we went across, as Europeans spread across the United States. Interestingly, though, honeybees were not brought to the United States or North America for pollination. They were brought for honey. And really, for the first several hundred years, that's what honeybees were here for. Nobody really thought about using them for pollination until the 1900s, as crop sizes got large and as we started to use certain agricultural chemicals, people started to see pollinator deficits. And they found that this amazing animal, just like when it was boxed up on a wagon train to take it to Oregon from the East Coast, could be boxed up and taken to pollinate crops. But from early on, we've been seeing issues with the honeybee. We've seen a 50% decline in managed hives since the 1950s. And feral hives have declined as well from a variety of causes. Pests, that's the varroa mite. Think about something the size of a kitten that would attach to you and suck your blood. It wouldn't make you feel very good. And that's the varroa mite, as well as diseases. But stagnant honey prices have played a role. China flooding the market with honey. But also neonicotinoid insecticides and other insecticides, habitat loss, moving these animals around. As Marla Spivak, who's at the University of Minnesota, she won a MacArthur Award for her work on honeybees. She sees it as kind of the straw that broke the camel's back, this decline in honeybees, in that we're seeing so many issues that finally they just collapsed. And we are seeing major declines. Before 2006, we had a lot of annual losses of 15 to 22% a year. But after 2006, that went up markedly. And last year, in some places, it was the largest losses that we've seen yet, 40% of honeybees for some commercial beekeepers. Can you imagine if you made whatever product or you raised cattle and you lost 40% of your cattle every year? It's devastating for some of these beekeepers. So what about native bees? Well, we know little about the status of many of our native bees, and as I said, there's over 4,000 of them. But I think we can make inferences from certain groups. As well as there's a few new studies coming out that are showing that bees may, these native bees may be in trouble. This is a brand new study, came out in December, and the study of wild bees, it was a modeling project that was used expert opinion and looked at habitat for bees and found that in 139 counties, as you'll see some in Missouri here, in key agricultural regions, we're seeing a mismatch between falling wild bee supply and bee pollinated crops. And that is very concerning because, as I said, honeybees are seeing lots and lots of troubles. And I think for a secure future agriculture, for agriculture, we need to be looking at our entire suite of pollinators, both honeybees as well as the wild pollinators. And if the wild pollinators are falling out, in the most important agricultural areas, that really is a problem. So, but that's only one model then, and there's a lot of species. So one thing that the Xerces Society, working with the IUCN Bumblebee Specialist Group, two of my staff are on the specialist group, as well as Ed Spieback is here. He's on the specialist group. He'll be speaking a little bit later. But we assessed all North American bumblebees and found that over a quarter of them are in an extinction category from IUCN. It means that they are in decline and there is the potential in the foreseeable future for them to go extinct. Over a quarter of all bumblebee species. And that should be really disconcerting because bumblebees, other than honeybees, are one of our most important groups for agricultural pollinators, for pollination. They're generalist pollinators that do a lot of pollination. And you can see here an example, the third one down, the rusty patch bumblebee. I bring that up because it was one of the most common bumblebees east of the Missouri and Mississippi River, and its relative abundance has declined by 92%. And that should really, really cause us concern. This is just a map to show you where a lot of these rare bumblebees are. Upper Midwest, we have many of these species. But here in Missouri, you have three of those species. And there's a lot of work to do, and agroforestry can really be part of the bumblebee issue more than some other issues. I also like to pull out butterflies. As I said, from a pollination point of view, they are not as important, especially from an agricultural point of view, but they do move pollen, and I think we can use them as one of the groups to look at. And NatureServe, which is a wonderful organization that assesses all the animal groups, has found that 17% of North American butterflies are in decline. But as I've talked to them and as I've looked at their data, one thing that really strikes me is that almost all of the species that they list out of the 17% are what we would call rare endemics. These are animals that always had a small footprint in the landscape. And as we've developed land for, you know, homes, supermarkets, agriculture, they've lost that habitat, and that's really why they're in decline. They were always had a small habitat area. Along about 2006 as well, that's when colony collapse disorder hit, I started trying to look a little bit more deeply into what was going on with butterflies because I was hearing rumblings from my colleagues. I was invited to give a keynote in Reading, England at an international butterfly conservation symposium, and I wanted to do it justice because my talk was on North American butterflies and conservation. So I reached out to 18 of my colleagues and asked them a series of questions, and the last question was, what is the take-home message for butterfly conservation in North America? This is Dr. Jarrett Daniels, one of the foremost experts on butterfly conservation in the world, and he epitomized, 15 out of the 18 people had almost the exact answer to my question. It's no doubt that these rare endemics are in decline. Of course, they've been in decline for a long time. They've had small habitat areas. But what should be most alarming to all of us is that this downward trend has now spilled over to include many previously more wide-ranging butterflies. What we started to see was, it wasn't just these rare endemics, it was these animals that we thought were secure. All of a sudden, they were starting to decline. And the monarch butterfly epitomizes this. A really common butterfly, over likely between 500 million and 1 billion individuals. And now, according to NatureServe, the population east of the Rocky Mountains is critically imperiled. So something's going on that is broader than just the rare endemics. You can also look at the regal fritillary, and this is NatureServe as well. I rely on NatureServe quite a lot. You can see the dark blue and light blue are extinct or presumably extinct. The reds, orange, and yellows are imperiled, and the green is secure and apparently secure. Kansas is the only state that's been assessed that seems to have a secured population of this butterfly. This was a wide-ranging butterfly that used prairie areas, and we've lost a lot of our prairie areas. Just a couple other things, because I think it's important. Everybody says these animals are in decline, so I like to really put out the data and depress everybody before we talk about the good stuff. There are a few long-term data sets for butterflies. Butterflies are a little easier to study. There's only 800 of them, still a lot, but not 4,000. They're well-known and well-studied. Breed et al. In 2013 looked at almost 20,000 butterflies in Massachusetts. 20,000 records, one-day counts of over 100 butterflies in Massachusetts. And what they found is, as many studies are showing, butterflies are moving north. They really did clearly show this. These butterflies seem to be moving north. But they also found pretty marked decline, especially in butterflies that overwintered as eggs or as first instar larvae. They did see marked declines. Another really important piece of data that this is the longest running study of butterflies in North America by Art Shapiro. And he has studied continuously some sites since 1972, all of his sites since the 1980s. These sites are all the way from the Bay. So this is, I don't know where the pointer, but maybe there. This is the Bay Area, San Francisco, and this is Lake Tahoe. And he's got sites that are a gradient from ocean up to the crest of the Sierra Nevada. And they're all in natural areas, but many of them are surrounded by a sea of development. And what he found is that species richness has declined at half of the sites, in many of the sites, markedly, especially at low elevations. And what's really interesting, I think, is that the data really shows that this is across fauna. Every butterfly group is affected by this decline. So he's seeing broad declines in every butterfly group out there. And that's really disconcerting when you think about it, because these are not areas that are being developed. These are natural areas, these are parks and natural areas, and we're seeing marked declines in these areas that we think are somewhat protected from you know, the vagaries of development, whether it be housing or agriculture. One of the interesting findings, I thought, was that they're seeing decline in some of the wide-ranging species as much as they're seeing from some of the rare species. So this is a broad faunal decline that we're seeing. We don't have a lot of data from the Midwest, but from both coasts we do, and I think it should be a cause for concern. So why are these pollinators in decline? Well, we have made their habitat inhospitable in many, many places. Animals need a place to live. And we, as humans, have taken over their habitat. And that is probably the number one issue that these pollinators face. But pesticides are also an issue. Mosquito control and as well as agricultural uses are definitely a threat, and there's data to support this. I do always like to point out, because I give a lot of talks to urban audiences, and I like to point out that according to USGS, more herbicides and insecticides are used in urban areas per acre than in most agricultural areas. So this is not just about the farmer. This is about all of us thinking about how we need to grow food, but also to live in our environment. And I have to say, this is my bias, I have much less tolerance for doing this for perfect roses and a perfect lawn than I have for feeding people. So I just always like to make sure I point that out. Now, a lot of folks have talked about, or have, I'm sure heard of, neonicotinoids. When I'm not talking to the press, because you have to shrink everything down for the press, I call them neonics. When I'm not talking to the press, I broaden it out because I think what I think of these as is highly toxic, highly persistent, systemic insecticides. There are six neonicotinoids that fall into that class, but there are some new pesticides that fall into that class as well. And what's really interesting about neonicotinoids is when they were put on the market in the 1990s, I really think that the people who were doing that were doing it because they thought this was these were going to be a better product. They have less mammalian toxicity. They thought they will be kept in the plant, so they will have less impact on other animals. What they really didn't foresee is that in one case, being systemic became a problem because these pesticides can be in the pollen and nectar, and bees and other pollinators visit that pollen and nectar. But I think the biggest issue is persistence. These chemicals are highly mobile and they're really persistent. In one study in crabapple, they showed that after one application, they found amounts of neonicotinoid in the plant after 6 years, after one application. We found them moving in soil, into water, and affecting other animals. So it's not just pollinators that are impacted by these systemics, these highly toxic, persistent systemics. Many of our predators, parasitoids, seem to be uniquely impacted if they eat animals that are feeding on plants with neonics, and we're seeing big issues in our aquatic environments. So these pesticides are one of the suite of issues we need to deal with. And the big issue with persistence, toxicity, is that we use a lot of these. These are now the most used class of insecticide in the world. This is just one. There are six of these. This was imidacloprid, which was introduced in 1994, and that's 1999, that's 2004, and that's 2009. So we're using a lot of these chemicals, and we need to think about how we're using them and where they can be used safely. Disease is also an issue. If we move animals across the landscape, whether they be butterflies for releases at weddings or bumblebees for pollination, they often can move diseases with them. And that's an issue, especially for bumblebees, that has been noted, is diseases moved by commercial bumblebees. And then the last issue is, I have this as climate change, but Michael Bean, who works for the Department of Interior, who used to be on Xerces Board of Directors, coined a term that I like better. It's climate destabilization. And what this really means is that the climate is becoming topsy-turvy. Climate change sounds fairly benign. But we were working with folks at Scenic Hudson a few years ago, and one of their restoration people who'd been around for 25 years said, how do I do restoration when in the last 5 years we've had the driest year on record, the wettest year on record, and two hurricanes? It's pretty hard. These animals are stressed for a variety of reasons, and climate destabilization is impacting them as well. All right, we could either go just drink tequila, or we can talk about solutions. It's a little early in the morning, so I'm even for me. So I'm gonna talk about solutions. So I really do believe there are solutions. I believe there are serious issues, and these serious issues have to be addressed. But I believe that there are many, many solutions that we can take to make a big difference. And the first thing we have to do if we want to move to conserving pollinators is to understand what they need. You know, of course, everybody knows that pollinators need pollen and nectar. They collect pollen and nectar. That's their food. And there's good data showing that if you have a diversity of native plants, and we have a speaker later today to talk about native plants, there are so many reasons to use locally native plants, but if you have a good diversity of native plants, a suite of native plants, a buffet of native plants that bloom from spring until fall, you can provide for a huge suite of pollinators, and you can increase the diversity and abundance of pollinators on the landscape. So they need their food. But a lot of people forget the other part, which is that animals need both food and shelter. They need a place to live. And most people, when they think of bees, they think of honeybees. And they think, well, honeybees, they're put in a hive, you know, they've got a place to live. But most of our native bees are not like honeybees, actually. Most of our native bees are solitary animals that provision a nest on their own. They're not social. Actually, most of our native bees, the ones that do all the work, are females, individual females. Sorry guys, the guys just sit around, wait on flowers for the ladies to come. They sip nectar, wait for the ladies to come, mate, and then that's about all they're good for. I'm not gonna go anywhere beyond that, because my wife may, she may say similar things, but it's the female, a single mom, that is provisioning a nest with pollen and nectar called a bee bread. They lay the egg on it, and then the larva, over the course of the year, in many cases, develop into a pupa and then emerge and come out. Mostly we don't see this, and so we forget that it's important. And 70% of our native bee species nest underground. They resemble ant nests. There are ways to conserve these, and I'll talk about that in a little bit, but we need to recognize that most of our native bees nest underground, and for the majority of the year, you don't know they're there. And that's something to really remember. About 30% of our native bees actually nest in old beetle burrows or twigs, hollowed out twigs, other nesting material like that. So agroforestry can be a really, really important part of this scenario, both for ground and wood nesting bees. And then we have our bumblebees, which are our true social bees, and we can talk about a couple of the other groups that are semi-social, which I can't get into today. But unlike honeybees, only one individual, the queen, lays eggs in the late summer, produces new queens, they go out and mate, they overwinter, they establish a new nest every year. So unlike honeybees, they don't nest year-round. The queen overwinters, and then they have a nest that grows and grows, may have hundreds of individuals. At the end of the season, new queens are produced. And so we need to think about where these animals nest in the landscape. And then we also should be thinking about butterflies. I know they're not as important from an economic point of view, but they're important from a diversity point of view. And just adding host plants into the landscape can often, if you're doing a project for bees, can often help the butterflies as well. And using asclepias, using milkweed, can really help our declining monarch and be really part of that solution. The other thing to remember is that pollinators are adapted to have their resources separated spatially. So you don't need the nesting site at exactly the same place that you need all of the flowers, but you need them close enough so these animals can move back and forth. But it is something to think about, is that they can move across the landscape. And then last, I always do like to point out, you know, in the Midwest, this is one of our Western species, but, you know, we've got the Powshink skipperling, we've got Dakota skipper. Sometimes you have specific species, and you really do need to take those into consideration when you're doing general habitat projects. Sometimes general habitat projects can really harm these habitat specialists, and so I like to throw that out. So if we're going to do this, we need to do this at a landscape scale. We need to be thinking about, today we're talking agroforestry, but I'm going to talk about how agroforestry can fit into the larger picture. Because if we really want to improve the picture for pollinators, we need to be working cross-landscape. Farms, natural areas, homes, all of these landscapes are ideally suited for pollinators and can be made incredibly pollinator friendly. The neat thing about pollinators, you know, in the past I've worked on, you know, salmon issues, worked on wolf issues, but the neat thing about pollinators is that anybody can do it. Anybody can provide the habitat for pollinators. We can't all go help the wolves. We should. I'm not saying that we shouldn't work to maintain wolf populations, but anybody can take action in their own lives with pollinators. But species need quality habitats, and when I'm talking about quality habitats, good native plants and places to nest, and they need to be able to move across the landscape. Remember I talked about climate destabilization, climate change. There's good studies from Europe that show where we have connections, animals are able to move north, able to move up into the mountains. We're able to conserve species because of these corridors. And we need to reduce stressors. You know, this doesn't mean that, and wouldn't it be neat, that we'd go pesticide-free tomorrow. But what it means is that we need to start thinking about how these pesticides are impacting the pollinators and how we need to ameliorate those issues, especially in the context of managed or new plantings or conserving areas where pollinators live. And the neat thing is there oftentimes you don't need to plant a thing for pollinators. We go out all the time and find areas that just need to be better managed, whether it's management through fire or grazing or management through not blanket spraying roadsides, but on the right-hand bottom, controlling invasive species. These can help the pollinators that are within the landscape. And we need to think about natural areas, because to me, natural areas, when I'm thinking at a landscape scale, are the glue that holds all the other habitat together. They're the bigger areas that we can use as focal points for these animals. But we need to manage these areas not just for pollinators, but for natural function. You manage a natural area for what it was supposed to be like, and the pollinators that were supposed to be there will likely show up. We need to think about them, but we don't necessarily need to manage for pollinators. But there are also many other areas. We've had huge success now working with farmers to improve habitats adjacent to farms, from the Northeast, Midwest, all the way out to the West. This is an example of one of our projects in the Willamette Valley. Farmers are interested in pollinators and understand the issue inherently because they're often growing crops that need pollination. They get it, and we can work with them. Roadsides are another important habitat. 17 million acres across the United States are in roadsides. And they can provide, Zierce Society just worked under a contract with the Federal Highway Administration to develop a literature review that really showed, the data really clearly shows that you can provide for all life stages of pollinators in roadsides. Of course, you have to manage them in certain ways. You can't just have grass, but it can be done. And the question always comes up, so I always head it off, is do we want pollinators on roadsides? Won't they be hit by cars? Actually, the data seems to suggest, actually really suggests, that if you have diverse native plantings, you have less roadkill. It makes sense. These animals aren't going to move any farther than they need to. If they have everything they need on one side of the road, they're not going to go over to the other side of the road. I'm looking for my joke about why the bee crossed the road here, but I haven't sort of come up with that yet. So he crossed the road because he didn't have enough habitat on that side. Power line rights of way. We have millions of acres of power line rights of way. This is perfect habitat for pollinators. And of course, agroforestry. And I'm just going to touch on a few of the practices that can really help. You know, hedgerows, windbreaks can be really important for pollinators. Forest farming, riparian forest buffers once they're replanted. These are willow plantings. Willow is a great early season nectar source for pollinators. Silva pasture. All of these practices can be tooled, can be finely tweaked, I believe. I hope, Gary, can they be? To be better for pollinators. And again, I know that we're not out there always doing agroforestry practice for pollinators, and I get that. You know, the idea is to make money. The idea is this is agroforestry. But where we can think about pollinators as we're doing it, we can add them into the mix. It's a historic time right now, and I'm so excited to be here at this historic time because everybody's talking about pollinators. When I started this, of course, as was mentioned earlier, entomologists knew that pollination was important. And we were some of the earliest people who started to see that pollinators might be in decline. But when Steve Buchman and Gary Nabhan wrote their book, Forgotten Pollinators, the number of us who were really talking conservation of pollinators could have fit around a large dinner table. And now we've got a room packed with people thinking about pollinators, and we have a White House actually thinking about pollinators. And we have a president who has said the word pollinators and conservation together, which is fascinating to me. So, and we have a lot of tools now at our disposal. And the first one is the Farm Bill. The NRCS and FSA were way ahead of the White House in embracing pollinators. And in 2008 and 2014, but first in 2008, the Xerces Society, many other groups, senators, worked together to add language to the Farm Bill that made pollinators a priority resource concern because of the issues with pollinators. That language was retained in the 2014 Farm Bill. What this means is that farmers can get cost share funding for habitat improvements, and that's huge with pollinators in mind. Also, just 2 months ago, the NRCS rolled out their new Monarch Initiative. There are specific funding sources for a variety of Farm Bill programs that you can now gear towards monarchs in 10 states, including Missouri. So that's another resource out there. Monarchs are not really great agricultural pollinators, but they do move pollen, and what you do for pollinators helps monarchs and vice versa. The talk out of the White House is luckily not just talk. They produced first the national strategy. The idea is to make sure that we have robust populations of honeybees and that we recover monarchs and that we are shooting for 7 million acres of new and managed habitat by 2020 for pollinators. And that's huge. And a research plan to look at these issues. So they're putting their money where their mouth is. We've got a number of step-down products being developed from the White House Council on Environmental Quality has a whole product guidance, which we helped with for landscapers, trying to improve urban areas for pollinators. The Forest Service BLM Interiors put out their best management practices. We're going to be helping to develop additional practices. As I mentioned, we're working with the Federal Highway Administration to develop best management practices. We've delivered those to federal highways. Those should be coming out soon. There's just a huge amount of emphasis, and the time is ripe for anybody interested in pollinators. Xerces has a huge variety of resources. The Agroforestry Center also has a whole variety of resources that you can use. Most of them are free. You can download them. We do have our book. I always like to give a shout out. This is kind of one-stop shopping for pollinator conservation. We can't give this away for free, but you can order it on our website. And I guess my take-home message is that agroforestry can be part of the mix of creating a broad suite of habitats out there where we can really improve the situation for pollinators. And I believe we can. These are resilient animals. You plant it and they actually will come. And I think that's pretty neat that we're in a situation we're in where we can take this on and actually hopefully win this one. So thank you for being part of the solution.
Morning.
Asking some. I always love to have a microphone, you know. Can sing songs and everything. That's great.
I want to see that. Can you sing?
Peg of my heart, I love you. Okay. Please. There's a, I can just yell and so we can all hear you.
They took your microphone.
Thank you, Scott. My question also, perhaps some of the MU agroforestry professionals yes. can address this as well. Certainly things like hedgerows and those woody species or in other places grassland species are important, but it is important to have the right habitat in the right place. And I think that, could you just speak about that a bit? For example, a hedgerow might benefit some pollinators, but we wouldn't want a hedgerow in an original prairie, for example, because that could be to the detriment of other species, versus you wouldn't necessarily want a grassland in a primarily forested area because that might, so could you just speak a bit about appropriate habitat enhancements?
Yes, and I touched on that when I talked about natural areas, because really we need to be thinking about, one, there are two issues here. One, we should be really thinking about what the habitat is and was, and you're going to have the best success in habitat projects that are similar or the same as what grew there in the past. And if you have remnant habitat, you should be keeping that remnant habitat. You also should be planting locally native plants wherever possible. Where we have a lot of opportunity is where we already have landscapes that have seen lots of management, like field edges and other things where most of our work with farmers has been in taking land out of production that is not very good, it's not very good land. And so the farmers are willing to take some of that land out of production. It's been plowed for 40 years. But you do need to be careful with exactly what you say. We shouldn't be changing remnant habitat. We shouldn't be putting hedgerows in the middle of prairie. But there are lots of places where we can do that. We also need to be extremely careful about all of this habitat adjacent to where pesticides, insecticides especially, might be used. And that's another consideration. You need to look at in the land, and that's why I talk about the landscape context. We need to be looking at this broadly and then dialing down and figuring out what we should do on that site-specific level. So thank you, Carol. That's a great question.
Other questions? Oh, wow. Okay, there's two back. Please, yes.
Thanks for a great presentation. I'm the chairman of the board of a St. Louis-based community gardening and urban ag organization. And this last Monday, I had a lunch meeting with a gentleman who is highly networked in Missouri commodity agriculture. And our purpose of our meeting was to talk about our schools program and our urban ag program and building some relationships with the commodities group. And toward the end of our conversation, I mentioned, you know, the Missouri monarch recovery strategy. I talked about what's going on in this whole pollinator conservation effort. And I sensed a real concern on his part as this movement being a threat to agriculture. And I'm just, and he's a great guy. He's very well educated. He's a fellow Mizzou grad with multiple degrees. And I'm just concerned about that. And I run into that. I mean, I've met with the Missouri Farm Bureau president for kind of the same reason. And when I brought up the milkweed issue, you know, again, I sensed a real threat of that movement. I'm just curious what you're finding and what are you all doing to try to build this. I think it's an education thing more than a real threat. I know it's not a real threat.
I agree with you wholeheartedly. We still have a ways to go, especially with some of the big commodity producers. We have made inroads with a whole variety of different ag sectors, but there are some that see it as a threat. What's interesting is once you go in and you talk about really what would need to happen on any individual farm, most people get it. And you know, we had we're part of this Keystone group, which includes big agribusiness and conservationists and agencies working on monarchs. And there was a farmer there. You know, the big agro groups are all concerned, and this farmer came on and really wasn't nearly as concerned as the spokespeople for him were concerned. And I don't know if that's universal, but we tend to see that when we can have these conversations. So it's really about education. There are lots that farmers can do to help the situation. They're really smart people. Many of them really care about the land, and I think we just need to continue to talk to them about the importance and about how it's not. We're not saying get rid of everything. We're saying here's what you can do within the suite of possibilities. So thank you for bringing that up. Good. But more needs to be done.
How many more questions? Two more. Right here, and then back up that way. One here, then back up there.
Thank you. Several decades ago, Rachel Carson brought to our popular, you know, the public's awareness about challenges to, well, birds in particular, but I believe some of her work was also about insects. And so what happened? I mean, she was addressing the crisis of her time, and now you and others are addressing the crisis of our time. Yeah. Have we been asleep at the wheel?
Yeah, unfortunately, this seems to be cyclic in that, you know, Rachel Carson raised the issue. What came out of that was a law, FIFRA, which regulates pesticides, but it's an unwieldy law that really doesn't, really should have been crafted better so that environmental issues are taken into more of account when pesticides are registered. So what we're seeing is this, you know, and often with good intentions. You know, what was really interesting is DDT was put on the market because we used things like carbamates and really nasty chemicals that were at the time thought to be worse than DDT. Then we replaced DDT with organophosphates and pyrethroids that were highly toxic to humans and others, but short-lived in the environments. Neonicotinoids and other systemics came on because they wanted chemicals that weren't as toxic to humans. But it does continue, and we really, I don't have a great answer for you there. Sometimes I feel like I'm tilting at windmills. I will continue to tilt at those windmills as long as I need to and try to get both the public as well as regulators to do a better job with these chemicals. What's really interesting, I think, is that the bees have really helped us in helping to educate the public as well as regulators about not just the neonicotinoids, but the pesticide issue in general and the problems that we might face. So it does seem like Rachel Carson all over again, and that's is disappointing, but we need to continue the struggle. I don't know if that's a great answer, sorry.
I think I would add one thing. It's based on how effective our bioassays are, and to include things that when we register pesticides or anything that goes into the environment, that that our criteria become more finite than they have been. And we've just learned more over the years, simply that. There's one last question in the back of the room. There you go.
I'd like to ask you, what are the consequences of genetically modified plants on pollinators, especially plant-specific pollinators, or are GMOs insignificant to pollinators?
Well, GMOs are highly significant, but not maybe for the reason you might think. Really, when you're talking about glyphosate, and I know that I'm thinking I might be in a room that is partially sponsored by Monsanto, so when you talk about glyphosate, it doesn't come without its consequences. The thing about Roundup Ready crops or glyphosate resistant crops is that they're very good, and they're so good that they allow the use of this product, and they eliminate all the weeds within and sometimes adjacent to these crops. And some of those weeds include milkweed and other flowering plants that pollinators use. So they are of significant consequence, because in the early 90s, our cropping systems, even corn and soy, because they were large monocultures then, but they were more diverse, and they're much, much less diverse now. And I do think we need to be looking at solutions. We always seem to be looking, and this is just my opinion, at the silver bullet solution, this one solution that's going to fix it all. And being an ecologist and entomologist, I know there's tons of pieces, and they all connect together, and I just think we need to be thinking about the pieces, not the silver bullet solutions that if we have this one product, we're going to fix it. And I come from integrated pest management, and that's where really Xerces Society and my personal aptitude is, to push us back to thinking about an integrated approach, not a one-size-fits-all approach like, to be honest, glyphosate resistant crops, but an integrated approach to how we grow crops, which I think will be better for the world. Doesn't mean eliminating pesticides. It means being more thoughtful about how they're used.
Thank you. Let's give Scott a round of applause.
Thank you, sir. Yeah.